Hello friends, welcome back once again. Before we start with part 2, let us recapitulate what we did in part 1. In part 1, we covered mainly what is curriculum, definition of curriculum, kinds of curriculum, in which we covered about social curriculum, information processing, personalist and behavioral curriculum, orientation of curriculum, mainly highlighting child-centered curriculum, society-centered curriculum, knowledge-centered curriculum, and eclectic curriculum. We start with part 2, mainly highlighting on understanding curriculum design and exposure to different types of curriculum. Let us start with curriculum design. Any curriculum that we need to design will come from analysis of the social needs. In society, whatever needs are felt, accordingly we try to develop the human resource according to those needs. Say for example, in 1950s, after we got independence in 1947, India was trying to develop its industry. And in 1950s, it was felt that there is dearth of good managers to look after the public sector organizations. Hence, in late 1950s, the felt for management institution was there, and then the Planning Commission recommended establishment of IIM and IIMs in 1961. So initially, two IIMs were established, one at Ahmedabad and the other at Calcutta. So, understanding that we required managers at that point of time, a course related to managers was to be developed, and hence the two institutions got established in 1961. Now, these two institutions then went in for developing the courses related to management, and they started with PGP programs. So, they started developing a program which started translating those social needs into course and learning objectives. These learning objectives and course objectives were then split into the specific objectives of what exactly is required. Let us try and understand what this point means. A manager is supposed to solve problem and is supposed to analyze different types of problems. Now, these problems may be related to money, it may be related to human resource, it may be related to selling of the products or services, or it may be related to operations of the organization. Hence, when we talk of the course or learning objective, the main objective was to develop analytical and problem-solving skills among people. And these skills have to be then classified into different types of skills related to managing of finances, looking after human resource, trying to look after the market needs and selling products and services accordingly, and also taking care of the operations of the organization. So when I talk of specific objectives, these are the types of specific objectives which I am talking of. Then comes a grouping of these specific objectives into subjects. Now, for each area which I have talked of, be it finance, marketing, operations, or human resource, you go into deeper details of what type of problem solving skills and analytical skills have to be developed. So accordingly, you go in for deciding which subject will take care of which type of objective. Say for example, in finance, you have accounting, you have financial management, you have paper related to taxation. So these are three different types of skills which you would like to develop among the managers when it comes to managing the money. And you can think of similar types of problems and thereby go in for developing some more subjects in that particular area. Next point is deriving the subjects from the above classification. So you will go in for deciding which all subjects you have to develop in order to take care of all those problems which we are talking in the above points. Then you specify the objectives related to those subjects. I will be discussing all this in detail in part 3 when I take up live examples with you. And then we go for unitizing each subject matter. So that means you must have seen in your syllabus that your subject is divided into unit 1, unit 2, unit 3, unit 4, and unit 5. And some subjects are divided into modules. So what you try to do is you try to group similar type of linked topics under each unit to cover up the various aspects together under each unit. And by completing 5 to 6 units, you try to see that a comprehensive coverage related to that particular subject is taken care of. And lastly, we look after how much time is required to cover up that particular subject. So usually 15 hours per credit is given under CBCS scheme, which we are nowadays following in different universities. And when we say 15 hours per credit, this means that if we are covering the syllabus by saying that it is a 4-credit course, we have to go in for giving 60 hours to it. And if we say it is a 3-credit course, it means that we have to allocate 45 hours to it. Now, what do we mean by credit? Credit is the weightage which is given to that particular subject, understanding the importance of that particular subject in the program. If you say a 3-credit course, it would mean that you have to go in for dedicating 3 hours per week for that particular course. Now, some institute may say that we give 2 hours for lecturing and we consider tutorial as 0.5, and therefore 2 lectures plus 2 tutorials, that is how they are giving a weightage of 3 credit to that particular course. If it's a 4-credit course, you may go in for giving 4 lecturing hours, or you may go in for giving 3 lecturing hours plus 2 tutorials, which form 1 credit, right? So that is how bifurcation of hours is also done. So you will find that when they say 3 credits, it is 2 lectures, which is written as 2L plus 2 tutorials, right? Or it may be 2 practicals if it's a course involving some practice in labs. And finally, with each subject taking care of all the required time period and unitization of the topics, you go in for amalgamating all the subjects together, which are required to create that particular program, and that becomes a syllabus. We now move on to types of curriculum, which is continuation from part 1, and this is where I left in part 1 by telling you that we are going to cover the following curriculum in part 2. So in this part 2, we are going to cover overt, explicit or written curriculum, as the name suggests, societal curriculum, hidden or overt curriculum, the null curriculum, phantom curriculum, concomitant curriculum and rhetorical curriculum. Now, when we try to make our student learn something related to the program for which he has taken admission in our college or the university, it is not that we are only making him learn about our subjects. Otherwise, he is going to be a man who knows theory and nothing else. As a teacher, it is our responsibility that when we teach in the curriculum, there are other things also about which we must talk in the class, because at the end of 2 years or 3 years of the program or 4 years of the program, depending upon the duration of that particular program, we want that a student should be developed in a holistic manner in the university. Already we are aware of the problems which we are facing as far as employment of our students are concerned, and that there has been a criticism that our engineers are not employable or our graduates are not employable. So somewhere we as teachers have to take this responsibility of making a student who is a holistic human being. He not only understands his subject, but he also understands the other problems of the society and how we can go in for making him a good human being, a good citizen of nation. We need to understand what types of curriculum we must talk of when we are there in the class. And therefore, this awareness as a teacher is very important for us. So let's start with overt, explicit or written curriculum. this is the basic curriculum which you as teachers go in for distributing in the class. And in the very first class, we talk about what we are going to cover in the subject which we are teaching. And we try to give the introduction to that particular subject and also circulate the copy of the syllabus to the students in the form of a hard copy or a soft copy. So curriculum which is written as a part of formal instruction of schooling experiences, overt curriculum, usually confined to those written understanding and directions formally designated and reviewed by administrators, curriculum directors and teachers, often collectively. Next is societal curriculum. This curriculum is defined as massive, ongoing, informal curriculum of family, peer group, neighborhood, churches, mass media and other socializing forces that educate all of us throughout our life. Now, as a human being, especially as a child, most of the time is spent at home and our parents are taking us into different social functions, be it religious gathering or be it a gathering of relatives, and everywhere we get to learn something from the society of how we are supposed to behave, how we are supposed to conduct ourselves in the society, and society is teaching us something or the other every day. So that's a societal curriculum. It will depend upon the family values, what parents want you to learn, how to interact with the society. All those things will be covered in that particular curriculum. We move on to hidden or covert curriculum. The hidden curriculum refers to the kind of learning children derive from the very nature and organizational design of schools, as well as from behavior and attitudes of teachers and administrators. Now, they are looking at us and we are role models for them. Now, by this, what I mean to say is, all students try to imitate the good qualities of the teachers. So how we teach and how we talk, students also try to learn from us as teachers. And this is very much evident when you ask about a teacher who is teaching your child, and you must have seen the child praising his teacher and he doesn't want to go against what the teacher has said. So that's the type of impact a teacher makes on the mind of the student when he or she is teaching in the class. Right. Now, there are a few things which we would like to understand, and I move back to the previous slide. So in this, I said organizational design of schools as well as from the behavior and attitude of teachers and administrators. Let's try and understand this highlighted part. So one example which I would like to highlight here is that students quietly raising their hands to be called on. That means when we are taking the attendance, there is a norm of the organization that you have to go in for raising your hand, right? So this is some type of a contract between a teacher and a student that I am going to call your name and you are going to raise hand, or you are going to say present sir, present madam. So these are some of the norms which get established in the class, and there may be in other types of norms. Now you may be saying that all students should be seated before the teacher enters into the class. So again, that is a norm which has been established by the organization, your college or university, and that is how we make our students learn about discipline. Then there may be some other hidden norm, like endless competition for grades. So we try to create competition among students so that they go in for learning better and better by competing with each other. And this type of competition is a healthy competition where the student like to score higher grade by competing with each other, and hence try to learn more and exhibit more as far as their knowledge is concerned. Then there are other type of messages which we give, discipline messages like sit straight, be alert, and asking questions regularly to ensure that students are listening. Now let's revisit what I said in the previous slide. The hidden curriculum refers to the kinds of learning children derive from very nature and organization design of schools, as well as from behavior and attitudes of teachers and administrators. And now these examples can be seen, and you will be able to appreciate what we have tried to discuss in that particular definition. Let's move on to the next type of curriculum. This is called as null curriculum. Now, you must have experienced in your teaching days, when regular sessions are going on, that we don't go in for covering 100% of the syllabus in the class, because we feel that about 80% of the syllabus is important and students need the teacher and teacher's input. But 20% of the syllabus is such that it should be left to the student to be covered by themselves. So we feel that the students should be doing it by themselves, and it will help them in learning the course in a better manner. And there is a concept of Sentient Group, which has come from Harvard. It is spelled as Sentient Group and pronounced as Sentient Group, wherein this concept says that if students study in their own groups, the learning is better. So sometimes we as teachers go in for giving them some assignments or exercises, and we ask them to do it by themselves. And you must have observed sometimes that the students sit together and then they try to discuss all those exercises and assignments, and they try to do it as a group study, right? Now, let's come to this definition of null curriculum and why we are saying this as null. That curriculum which we do not teach, thus giving students the message that these elements are not important in their educational experiences or in our society. So we feel that they can do it by themselves. It is not that we go in for teaching them in the class. And somewhere we also feel that it's not very important from our social point of view. Somehow, somewhere, some people are empowered to make conscious decision as to what is to be included and what is to be excluded from the overt curriculum, right? So there are some topics which you need not cover, but then it is expected that when you are teaching a curriculum, there are some prerequisites which the student will always have, and that will be taken care of. Let me give you an example on this. Say, for example, you are a business communication teacher and you are teaching a class of an MBA. Now, it is understood that when the student comes to a postgraduate level, he need not be given a session on English language. He need not be told about prepositions, articles, sentence structures. So this type of thing he must have learned. And hence, from day one, I can start talking about the communication with this type of a student, understanding that I need not go in for teaching him English language once again. Certain subjects or topics are left from the overt curriculum, considering that topics are not important for the study. So this is null curriculum, which we usually ignore, and we say that this curriculum will be covered by the students by themselves, or we don't cover it in the class, but we go in for giving them in the form of an assignment or small exercises, considering that it will be easy and the student will be able to cover it by themselves. We move on to the next, phantom curriculum. The inculturation of students into the predominant metaculture. Now, just it's very interesting to learn about this curriculum. The student is reading newspaper, he is watching television, he or she is looking after her mobile phone and the messages coming on the mobile phone. And nowadays you must have seen that mobile phones have become a big nuisance. It is exposing our students to all type of things on internet, right? So sometimes they come across violence, or they come across some objectionable material which they should not be coming across at a given age. And hence we are not teaching them, but they are learning something from outside, right? And children learn by observing celebrities also. So we find that our buying decisions sometimes are influenced by our children, and their decisions are influenced by the celebrities on television or in newspaper or on mobile phones, especially YouTube, when they are watching and there are some interruptions coming in. Those interruptions, be it an advertisement or any other thing, has a very big impact on their thinking. So even though this curriculum is not there anywhere, but it's still working, right? And when it is still working, it is having impact on their behavior also. So we must also try to see, when we are developing the curriculum, what all they should read from the newspaper related to our subject, what all clippings they should be watching on YouTube related to our subject, and what type of news channel they should be watching, if at all news channels are covering something related to our subject. And that's how this type of curriculum can then be taken care of for our students. Next is concomitant curriculum. What is taught at home, or those experiences that are part of a family's experience or related experiences sanctioned by the family. So religious expressions, values or morals come under this. Now, this would mean that right from childhood age, mothers teach daughters of how to dress up. Daughters also see mothers, how they are dressing up and what type of fashion they are doing. Sons watch their fathers, and they try to follow what their fathers are doing. And we tell them to respect our elders, touch their feet, go to temple or gurudwara or church or mosque on Sundays or on Fridays or any other day which is important for us, right? Now, this type of things are being taught under this curriculum called as concomitant curriculum, where we mainly teach them about the religious expressions, our value system, and morals of morals which they should learn being the member of our family. Next is rhetorical curriculum. So rhetorical curriculum comprise of the ideas offered by policymaker. So you must have seen that when Modi government came into power in 2014, they started emphasizing on smart cities, Swachhta Abhiyan, and Startup India. Now, understanding that this is becoming the policy of the government, and the government is trying to promote all these things, many educational institutions, especially our university, also went in for developing subjects on Swachh Bharat, smart cities, and startup, which we have incorporated in the course curriculum of our undergraduate programs and postgraduate programs. So over a period of time, as we are teaching our students, we also have to look around what type of policies are coming up, and accordingly we have to upgrade our syllabus related to those policies. So you must be always taking care of what is happening in the environment, especially political environment or economic environment. And accordingly, in order to upgrade the skills of our students and also the knowledge of our students, we must go in for offering these types of courses in the programs when we are offering the program. And the courses must be upgraded every 2 to 3 years if possible. If we don't upgrade our courses for more than 8 or 10 years, then we will always go in for giving an outdated skill to our students, and the outcome is that they don't get employed. So what are the curriculum development phases? These are the three types of curriculum development phases: instructional development, material and media development, and methods of teaching and testing. Now, in the next part, I will be covering up with structure of curriculum, and I will show you live example of how we go in for developing the syllabus for one subject and what type of course outlines have to be developed. So that will cover the headings of introduction, scope, aims and goals, courses of studies, methodology, material, media, evaluation scheme, outcome and world of work. So this will be taught in the next part. So we end this part here and see you again in part 3. Thank you very much.